Next is your concept of ecosystem, producer, consumer and decomposers, energy flow in an ecosystem, food chain and food webs, ecological pyramids and ecological succession. So let us go and check this out. Concept of ecosystem. This word ecosystem was first coined by A.G. Tansley in the year 1935. Okay. So what do you mean by ecosystem? Ecosystem, in a simple meaning, it is a self-sustained ecological unit in which the biotic components interact with the abiotic components, right? So this may seem to be a little bit tough for you guys, so let me make it easier. So suppose there is an area, okay, and you have observed there are certain living organisms as well as non-living organisms. So if you combine all those, then it forms an ecosystem, right? So we can say the sum total of the biotic, that is the living organism, and the abiotic component, that is the non-living entities present in an area, and their interaction among themselves, it's termed as ecosystem. The biotic components, like I said, includes all the living organisms such as plant, animal and microbes which interact with each other as well as their surroundings. The abiotic components such as the non-living substances, okay, which includes atmosphere, hydrosphere, lithosphere, mineral, nutrients, etc. Just like, let me be very much simple and precise in this regard. The biotic components includes all the living organisms including us as well, and the abiotic components consist of temperature, light, climate, right, air, this pressure, the pH, concentration of gases, etc., in which we are dependent, isn't it? The plants are dependent upon the carbon dioxide for the photosynthesis. Not only carbon dioxide, they are dependent upon the light also, right? We human beings are also dependent upon the oxygen, right, for our survival, sustainability, isn't it? So that means what? We are interdependent with each other and the environment, right? The biotic components are dependent on the abiotic components for food synthesis, like I said, as for example photosynthesis, energy, reproduction, growth and development. Okay, so what about the heterotrophs? Heterotrophs are those organisms which do not prepare their own food, but they are dependent on other living organisms. So if the plant are not able to produce this food, then the consumers will not be able to survive. Okay, an ecosystem may be natural, as for example forest, ocean or desert ecosystem, or man-made such as crop field, pond, aquarium, etc. Okay, so here you can see the pictures of various ecosystems. Okay, now what is the size of an ecosystem? The size may range from a small drop of water, which is called also called as nano ecosystem, to as large as the entire planet, which is called as macro ecosystem. Okay, so you may imagine how a small drop of water can be a ecosystem. So let us go through the definition of ecosystem. Like I said, it is the sum total of the biotic and abiotic components present in an area. Okay, so biotic means the living components. So in the water drop, if you observe it under microscope, then you will see minute microorganisms which are living in nature. Okay, and the water itself is an abiotic component, that is non-living substance. Okay, then the pH of the water. Okay, pH basically means the acidity, it determines the acidity or basicity of a substance. Okay, that is another topic. So and the various chemicals contained in the water drop itself is a abiotic component. So here you can see there are two components present in it, the biotic, which are the microorganisms, as well as the abiotic, which are the certain parameters like chemical, pH, water itself, etc. Okay, so they are interacting among themselves, isn't it? The microorganisms are interacting with the abiotic components for sustainability, right? So in this regard, it also forms an ecosystem. Now you can see on the other hand, it may be as large as the entire planet. Obviously the earth itself is an ecosystem, because here you can see the both the living organisms as well as non-living substance, isn't it? And they are interacting among each other for survivability and sustainability. Now let us go through some major ecosystems of the world. Forest ecosystem, and we'll be dealing about the forest ecosystem and the plant pond ecosystem, okay, out of the other ecosystems. So forest ecosystem comprises of living organisms and the non-living entities found in a forest area. Okay, there are various type of forest ecosystem throughout the world. For example, temperate forest ecosystem, tropical forest ecosystem, tropical deciduous forest ecosystem, etc., and so on. So the typical structure of a forest ecosystem may be summarized as follows. Like I said, an ecosystem comprises of biotic and abiotic components, isn't it? So the biotic components of a forest includes the tigers or the other plants, trees or the other plants, okay, and all the higher group of animals, okay. And mostly the trees falls under the category of producers, okay, which the we know, like we know, they used to prepare the food by the process of photosynthesis, right? And second category is your consumers, okay. Under the biotic components, we have broadly three categories, that is producer, which prepares the food, consumers, which consumes the food, and decomposers, which decomposes the food, okay. So in the forest ecosystem, the producers are mainly trees or other plants, okay. They utilize the sunlight for preparation of the food. Next is your consumer. Consumer includes certain other subcategories such as the herbivores, carnivores, and omnivores. I'm pretty sure you must have a basic idea about all these terms. Like herbivores are those group of animals which feeds on grasses or plants, basically. Carnivores, which feeds on meat, and omnivores, which feeds on both plants and meat. Okay, so herbivores of the forest ecosystem are also known as the primary consumers because they are the first one to consume the producers. Okay, as for example, the ants, leaves, bug, and deers. Leafhopper, bug, and deer. Second is your carnivores. Carnivores are those that feed on the herbivores, as for example, you can see birds, frogs, hyena, etc. Then comes your top carnivores. Now, what do you mean by this top carnivores? Top carnivores means the organisms which are present at the apex of an ecosystem. Okay, that means they used to eat the other organisms. Okay, but they are not eaten by any other organisms. Okay, that means they are like the king of a kingdom, we can say. Now, top carnivores like lion, tiger, vulture, etc., that feed on herbivores, and carnivores are the tertiary consumers. So in this regard, we, based on the level of consuming, we used to assign the names such as primary consumer, secondary consumer, and tertiary consumer. So in this regard, the herbivores are the primary consumers because they are the first one to consume the food from the plants, and the herbivores are consumed by the secondary consumers, okay, and the secondary consumers are consumed by the tertiary consumers, okay. So decomposers, like I said, these are mostly some bacteria and fungi, okay. As for example, Actinomycetes is a fungi, are the decomposers in the forest ecosystem. What they do is to break the complex plant body into a simple substance, and then they used to recycle the nutrients back into the environment, okay. So these were the examples of biotic components present in the forest ecosystem. Next is your abiotic components. The abiotic components mostly, like I said, include the non-living entities, as for example, moisture, gas, chemicals present in the soil, environmental parameters like light, temperature, etc. The abiotic factors are vital for the growth, reproduction, and development of this substance, okay, interacting biotic components. That means the biotic components are dependent upon this abiotic components for their growth, sustenance, and reproduction. So here is an example of the forest ecosystem where you can see a large number of trees, large trees, which are as the primary producers of this forest ecosystem. Okay, here you can see the rabbit, which is a herbivore, which is the primary herbivore, right, or primary consumer, we can say. Then comes your fox, which is a secondary consumer, or the mouse, which is a secondary consumer, right? And the hawk is at the top of your pyramid of this forest ecosystem. In this regard, it is known as the top consumer. And you can see the fungi, which are basically decomposers of this ecosystem. Next is your pond ecosystem. Ponds are basically the aquatic freshwater bodies, okay, which are found in the naturally present in the depressions of the earth surface, or they are sometimes made artificially as well. They consist of a quiet body with no wave-like action, okay. In the river, you can see there is a wave-like action. In the ocean, you can see there is a wave-like action. There are waves generating, but in case of ponds, you won't see naturally waves being produced, okay. So the total biotic and abiotic components present in the pond constitute the pond ecosystem, okay. So what are the examples of biotic components? They are mostly the planktons or fishes or crustaceans, okay. Planktons are the small group of organisms, okay, which are known as which may basically come under the category of phytoplankton as well as zooplankton. Phytoplankton means related to the plants, and zooplankton means related to the animals. Then the abiotic components mostly include the water, chemicals dissolved in the water, environmental parameters like pH, temperature, etc. So the typical structure of the pond ecosystem may be summarized as follows. Biotic components of the pond ecosystem comprises of the following. First is your producers, which are the minute floating phytoplanktons, and rooted or large rooted plants are the producers in the pond ecosystem. Okay, like I said, phytoplankton is a small group of organisms, aquatic organisms, which are autotrophic in nature. Okay, so they form the producers of the pond ecosystem. Next is your consumers. Mostly the insects, crustaceans and tiny fishes are the primary consumers, followed by the small carnivorous species, which are the secondary consumers, and the large carnivorous species, which are known as the tertiary consumers in a pond ecosystem. Decomposers. In favorable temperature conditions, aquatic bacteria and fungi cause rapid decomposition at the bottom of the pond, right? Mostly the fungi and bacteria are responsible for decompositions. Here also you can see, right? And the abiotic components mostly include the water, gases and chemicals dissolved in the environment. There is the aquatic environment, and the certain factors like light, temperature, pH also comes into act for sustaining the life of the biotic components. This is an example of pond ecosystem where you can see the producers, mostly the planktons, right, algae or the rooted plants, followed by the herbivores, mostly the insects, and the carnivore and top level carnivores you can see in this picture. Now, like we have been discussing about the term producer, consumer and decomposer all throughout the forest ecosystem and pond ecosystem. So what basically are these? So producers, in very simple language, it is a group of organisms, or simply producer is an organism which can prepare its own food. Okay, so as for example, the green plants, like, you know, and some of the bacteria. Now what is the difference between these green plants and some of the bacteria? I am pretty sure you must not have heard that bacteria also does this mechanism of autotrophism, right? So as autotrophism can be divided into two categories. First is your photoautotrophs, that is preparation of food with the help of light. Okay, here photo is related to the term light. And chemoautotrophs, that means autotrophism related to the chemical intake of substance, raw materials. Okay, intake of chemicals such as the raw materials or inorganic substances for the preparation of food. Here no light is required for the production of food. Okay, so producers basically comprises of the photoautotrophs as well as the chemoautotrophs. Okay, so if you are to write as a whole, then you can simply write it, producers are those group of organisms which prepare their own food, finish, right? As for example, green plants and certain bacteria. Now how do they prepare their own food? As a very typical example is of the photosynthesis. Like we have studied in our lower classes, that photosynthesis, in the process of photosynthesis, the sunlight, solar sunlight is utilized, right? Chlorophyll acts upon it. Chlorophyll helps in trapping the sunlight, and thereby, by the utilization of certain inorganic raw materials such as carbon dioxide and water, glucose is being prepared. Okay, and in this product, oxygen is being liberated as a byproduct, isn't it? So this is the simple mechanism of photosynthesis. So through this process, the green plants, mostly they used to prepare their food. Okay, consumers are those group of organisms which do not prepare their own food, but they are dependent on other organisms. Okay, so you can name a lot of examples under this consumer category, right? Such as you can say all group of animals. Okay, so the consumers are also divided into certain categories based upon the interaction with the primary producers. Okay, so the first one to interact or consume from the producer is known as primary consumer, and the primary consumer, if being eaten by the other consumer, it is known as, that particular consumer is known as secondary consumer, and the secondary consumer, if being eaten by the another consumer, it is known as the tertiary consumer. So let me give you a very simple example. Here the producer is mostly green plants. Okay, the primary consumer, let us take for example, is your grasshopper. Okay, and the grasshopper is feeding on this producer, so it becomes a primary consumer. Then the grasshopper is being eaten by the frog, right? So here the frog becomes a secondary consumer, and the frog is being eaten by the snake, so the snake becomes your tertiary consumer. Okay, like this it goes on. So normally the consumer which dominates the ecosystem, okay, that means the consumer is not being eaten by any other organisms, then it is termed as a top consumer. Okay, decomposers, some these are also heterotrophs, that means they don't prepare their own food, they obtain their nutrition mostly from the dead organic substances, okay, dead organisms, in which they break down the complex substance of the living organisms, okay, and convert it into a simple substance. So let us take for an example, you can see this the mango tree is behind me, right? The leaves, when it falls down, it starts to rot, okay. So after a few days you won't find any sign of this leaf. How does that happens? So once it falls down, various bacteria and fungi starts to act upon it, okay. They used to dissolve the leaf matter, okay, and then they used to absorb it, okay. They don't have mouth like us, right? Neither they have teeth. So what they used to do, they used to release certain chemicals which used to dissolve the plant material, and then this dissolved liquid is absorbed by the bacteria's body, okay. So the decomposers normally feeds on the organic litter, carcasses, rotten vegetables, fallen leaves, dead bodies, etc. The decomposers play a very vital role in the cycling of nutrients in the environment, okay. Yes, this is very true. If suppose there are lots of waste being generated in your house, okay, and if, then what happens if you don't discard those wastes, okay, then automatically there will be a abnormal condition in your home, isn't it? So likewise, if you recycle it, or if you throw the dust, throw the waste away, okay, if you dump it somewhere else, then okay, then your house remains clean, right? Or let us take another example. Suppose you have planted certain crops in an field, right? So suppose you have sown some sort of seeds. In the first season, you have got abundant amount of products, right? Plant products. But what if that particular plant material is not decomposed, okay? You won't be able to cultivate on that particular land. You need to clear it, isn't it? So recycling of nutrients is very much essential so that the fertility of a particular land remains constant, okay. So the breakdown of complex substance which is stored in the organism's body during the lifetime, what happens, when a living organism dies, as for example the plant, the amount of complex substances which it has stored in its body throughout its lifetime, okay, it breaks down and it gets mixed into the soil, okay, thereby making the soil fertile, okay, and this in turn can be utilized by the another plants for its nutrition and growth, okay. In this way, the nutrient cycling takes place in our environment.